So, Attorney Roque, let's talk about several issues which that many feel that you've either pivoted or they were confused on where you stood. A viewer is asking, now can you say, how did you really feel when President Duterte pardoned Pemberton? You were the lawyer of Jennifer Laude, that's the victim of the US soldier Pemberton. And of course, that was, you had statements coming from the president then, and you had to justify the good conduct time allowance. I'm asking you now, how did you really feel when Pemberton was pardoned?
Absolutely heartbroken, close to tears, but I pivoted. And I actually pounced on the opportunity to get vaccines. I actually told the president, this was most painful to me and the family, but I think we can use this to get the vaccines that we did, that we needed. And I think we did get the vaccines after he was pardoned.
But you mean to say at that particular time, when Pemberton was pardoned, you were already aware that we would need vaccines at that particular time?
Yes, there was already the pandemic at that time, and we had difficulties getting the vaccines, no? And we needed, I thought, you know, something big for which the Americans would be grateful, and I think it worked. And that's why I said sometimes you need to accept defeats for a bigger interest, no? And that was actually the issue of vaccines. So this is the first time I'm revealing it, no?
Yeah.
But of course, I was broken because it took us a year to convict him of marathon hearings, and we failed in our advocacy to let him kiss the rails of a Filipino jail, because until the very last day, he was not really detained in a Filipino jail. But I thought there was a bigger interest at stake, and that was availability of vaccines. So, and shortly thereafter, the U.S. became our biggest donors for vaccines. So I think all is well after all.
But okay. I wanted to ask you, did you think of resigning during that time?
No, I already had a very good sense of how policy and decisions were made in the office of the president. You always have to consider the bigger interest. And in this instance, I had no difficulties accepting. And I did say so, no, that this is for a bigger interest. I was just not specific about it because it would not be proper to say this is an exchange of vaccines. But for all intents and purposes, we wanted the Americans to commit to give us a substantial amount of vaccines. And of course, there was Pemberton, and there was also the Visiting Forces Agreement. No? So together, I think that gave us the vaccines that we needed. So anything that you do for the very good of everyone, you accept, even if there's some interests that are affected. No? And in this case, it was a personal interest because I really wanted to see him behind bars in Muntinlupa.
So this one, I'm curious, this is more of a behind the scenes question is, did the president tell you, or at least the team, that he would pardon Pemberton? Or were you shocked? Because I asked the U.S. ambassador about that, and he said he was surprised. And I'm curious.
I was shocked.
Did he not inform anyone?
No, he did not. No, I was shocked. And later on, though, he had a one-on-one with me to explain.
Okay.
And of course, I understood. And at that time, pandemic was the number one consideration. So I let it be. But it was very painful.
Okay. And you told the president that?
Yes, I said, of course, we're hurt because this guy has been treated with kid's gloves. And alam naman niya, this is why we are both against the VFA. You see, you could not divorce Pemberton from the issue of VFA, which the president, as you know, already terminated previously. No? And part of the reason, of course, is our experience that Pemberton was never under Philippine jurisdiction at any point in time, which is why we say it's derogation of our sovereignty and jurisdiction. No? So he understood that. But of course, he had bigger interests at stake. And in the end, I had to agree. And I think it was the right decision.
So what happens if Harry Roque becomes a senator? Where do you stand when it comes to the Visiting Forces Agreement?
Will continue. We started, we petitioned the Supreme Court to have it declared unconstitutional. We failed. We look for another occasion. And of course, if I do make it, particularly if I'm elected in what would be the administration party, then I would argue that this VFA is not towards our national interests and should in fact be rescinded, as the president had already previously declared.
Okay, but given the times today, you've seen China's encroachment of the West Philippine Sea, you're seeing the battleground there in terms of, we'll go to that later on because you are the international law expert, which many now question, where does Harry really stand with this? What will he do if he's senator? Isn't U.S. presence more important than ever now and strengthening the visiting forces agreement? There was talk that the United States wanted even to strengthen the EDCA. They wanted to strengthen the Enhanced Defense Cooperation Agreement, which Senator Ping Lacson, who is running for president, by the way, supports. So you would still want the VFA canceled if you become senator?
Yes. Under international law, in the law on international responsibility, no, a country that allows its territory to be used in a manner inimical to another incurs international responsibility. Meaning, if the bases here are used as a staging ground for an aggressive act on the part of the United States, then that makes us part of the conflict. I think the important thing is we should not have any reason to be dragged in a conflict that we have no interest in. We have no interest in the ongoing battle for supremacy between the United States and China. Our interest is to achieve peace and prosperity so we can benefit from the prosperities of both China and the United States. And the presence of these bases, whether we like it or not, will draw us in a conflict that will not benefit us and will only lead to the loss of lives of Filipinos.
Uh-oh. But isn't the visiting forces agreement necessary for the mutual defense treaty in a practical point of view?
Not really, because we don't need our soldiers to be trained by American troops. That's the visiting forces agreement. Why? Because they're the most battle-tested armed forces in the whole world. We have the longest-running insurgency, according to Guinness Book of World Records. It's more of the Americans trying to gain insights, no, and benefits from the combat experience of our troops.
Okay. Now, I want to ask you in several instances, of course, your statements when it comes to the West Philippine Sea have been quite controversial through the years. As if we go back to history, in 2012, for example, before President Duterte became president and way before you were spokesperson, you were very critical of China. And you've even, I won't read the whole quote, no, because it's a bit long, but let's just put it that you've even called on Philippine policymakers to make sure that they know they'll get nowhere with China negotiations, and that China would just want to, in effect, rule over the West Philippine Sea. This is basically a theme you've had prior to the president being the president of the country. And then you've had controversial statements as spokesperson, such as Julian Felipe Reef was never ours. And what will Harry Roque stand for if you're senator?
You see, Karen, you need to distinguish that you needed to have different positions on China in the West Philippine Sea, depending on whether or not you're talking of post or pre-arbitral award. Pre-arbitral award, you needed to use strong language because we had nothing to support our claims. Post-arbitral award, there's nothing that China can do declaring that they have no legal basis, no, to claim territory on the basis of historic claims to water. So anything that happened after the arbitral award, China just has to accept that this is part of international law, which is the position of the president and which is the correct position. But prior to the arbitral award, you had nothing. You had to like say matters or say statements that would entice China, in fact, to bring this to adjudication. Of course, China never did, but I was the first to propose that under the UNCLOS, there was a mandatory and compulsory dispute settlement procedure that did not require a separate consent for China. And if you recall, even Justice Carpio differed in his view. He said it should be mandatory conciliation. And I said that cannot be because conciliation will never lead to a resolution of the issues. So that is what is important. After the arbitral award, with a ruling saying that they have no, there's no such thing as historic claim to title, then you can move forward because there's nothing that China can do to erase that decision, which already forms part of international law. And because your legal position is now very clear, crystal clear, then you can move on and say, perhaps we could set this aside momentarily and deal with issues that we can actually advance, such as issues on tourism, trade, and investments.
Uh-oh.
Nothing has changed.
Yeah. So if you are, if you do win a Senate seat, how would you want the Philippines to move forward with China? Like, first of all, I wanted to ask you, did the president really promise China that we would remove the BRP Sierra Madre in Ayungin Shoal?
I don't think so. He never made that promise, not because he knows that the Sierra Madre has the effect of constructive possession. And of course, it was there because it could provoke the application of the Mutual Defense Treaty, since it was a naval vessel. And under the Mutual Defense Treaty, an attack on a naval vessel is an attack on our territory. But having said that, you know, I don't think the U.S. will come to a rescue when America tries to pull away a rusted ship in Ayungin Shoal. We're deceiving ourselves. No? I mean, China already got two islands, Mischief Reef and Scarborough Shoal, and America did not come to our rescue, which is something that Filipinos have to acknowledge. So what is the solution? Well, national defense can only be done by Filipinos. And the only way we can effectively defend our national territory is if we grow our economy to the point that we can allocate sufficient resources to our national defense. We cannot leave it to foreigners. And that is why I'm enjoining everyone to make the economy, the Philippine economy, as vibrant as ever, which we have achieved prior to COVID, so that we can modernize our armed forces and defend our territory ourselves.
Okay, just very quickly on this. Do you believe, I mean, some senators have spoken about this already, pero kung senador ka po, anong sasabihin mo, dapat ba i-upgrade na ang BRP Sierra Madre or even magtayo na ang Pilipinas ng isang facility doon?
Alam mo, madali magsalita. But China will never allow it. And again, unless you have an economy that can support a viable defense machinery, no, you cannot do it. But perhaps no, in the near future, when we become a newly industrialized country, then we can allocate resources and we can have sufficient ships that will deter any foreign navy from doing as we please in Ayungin Shoal. No? Mm-hmm. You have to remember that even repairing the port facility in Kalayaan already entailed substantial controversy. No? I know personally the contractor there, and they've had to deal with harassments from Chinese authorities. No? So okay. We also have to be grounded, no? That we can't do anything just because we said so, because there are realities on the ground that we are simply no match to the Chinese military prowess.
Okay. Now, Attorney Roque, this is a good question from another viewer, but it's more of something you can comment on. This is a businessman, and he says, Karen, his position on issues are so confusing. He is a flip-flopper. So this is good to address now, because that's when voters get confused. You're able to reason. You're a lawyer in every situation, right? You're able to find the defense of every stand. Then you end up asking, where is Harry Roque? Where does he really stand? Anong sagot mo, Attorney Harry, sa viewer na ito who will be a voter? His positions on issues are so confusing. He's a flip-flopper. Go ahead.
When I spoke on behalf of the president, I articulated the president's views. When I spoke as a legislator, as a lawyer, as an advocate, then those are the views of Harry Roque. Mm-hmm. I did not flip-flop. There are simply issues that we had different positions as far as the president and I are concerned. Death penalty, age of criminal responsibility, sometimes even federalism. No? So you just have to understand that it was a job. As a spokesperson, I could not debate with my principal. I could only articulate the views of my principal. You are an extension and you cannot rise above the source. There was no flip-flopping.
Okay, so Attorney Roque, if you are a senator, some questions that have come in here, would you support, there's been a bill that's long been lobbied. It's the anti-discrimination bill for the LGBTQ community. This is just quickly. We don't have to expound on this now. Would you support that legislation?
I was co-author of that in the 17th Congress.
Yeah. How would
I will even support same-sex marriage, because I think the decision on who you want to marry is a personal decision, which could not be limited by the state.
Okay. You were also the author of the universal health care law. And it's some say it's not quite as successful as it should be. I mean, at least when it was crafted. Pag nanalo po kayo, ano ang gagawin nyo at babaguhin sa universal health care law?
Alam mo yung original version ko, Karen. Nais ko nang buwagin ang PhilHealth. At papalitan naman po natin ang National Health Service. Bakit? Kasi kasabay ng pagdinig ng universal health care, nagdinig din tayo, nag-hearing din tayo doon sa korupsyon sa PhilHealth. At ang aking assessment, napaka-systemic na ng korupsyon doon, na napakahirap na talagang tanggalin yung mga tao doon kung susunod ka pa sa civil service law. And that the ultimate solution is to abolish and replace so that you can in fact remove those that have been benefiting, no? Have been, at sinasabi ko nga, yung mga buwaya at mga baboy dyan sa PhilHealth, no? Now, we've gotten to the point that I think that has to be done. Why? Even Secretary Dominguez, who originally was a strong advocate of just automating PhilHealth to address the issue of corruption, has given up. He has said that it has been almost a year and a half since we proposed automation, and until now, PhilHealth has not done anything. And I think it was intentional. Kasi nga, pag na-automate, mababawasan yung corruption. So I'm now re-examining if we should implement what I originally thought should be done to replace the PhilHealth with the National Health Service, just so that we can remove the really corrupt individuals in PhilHealth, no? As well as to penalize also those who are members of the medical community in collusion with these corrupt individuals. Pero nakakasayang talaga. Can you imagine? Bukod pa dun sa premiums, meron na tayong contribution from PAGCOR, from PCSO, from the syntaxes, from budget for the DOH and budget for PhilHealth. Billion-billion talaga ngayon ang ginugugol natin sa PhilHealth. At kung yan masasayang lamang sa corruption, that could be spent better to promote the health of all Filipinos. So I remain committed to re-examining whether or not we should replace PhilHealth with the National Health Service. No? At the same time...
Pero palagi mo, Attorney Kakayanin, ito, you do, we talked about it, you do have Senator Ralph Recto, who's offered PhilHealth. So how would you then... that's quite difficult. That's a tough one. So how would you do that?
Well, number one, by that time, I hope to have a role reversal. No? He would be in the House and I would be in the Senate. No?
Okay.
But I think... it's just being objective. Is there a way to clean up PhilHealth? So far, isa pa lang natatanggal dyan. Despite all the controversies of WellMed, despite all the controversies about fraudulent claims for pneumonia, for cataract, no? Isa pa lang natatanggal. Do you really think na yung isang tao orchestrated all the fraud in PhilHealth? Otherwise, it's business as usual in PhilHealth. And meanwhile, hospitals are complaining na hindi sila nababayaran. And alam mo, when we were drafting the bill, We had two options, either to nationalize the private health sector, which we're providing majority of our health services, or to let them remain and let PhilHealth be the sole purchaser of all goods and services. Now, we opted for the latter because privatizing them would have meant 5 trillion pesos. No? Pero clearly, pag hindi mo binayaran yung private sector at they opt out of the system, sino magbibigay ng medical services na kailangan at the time of pandemic? No? So it is... this important at the time of pandemic to ensure that PhilHealth is run in a manner where we minimize corruption. No? And I'm hoping that in the future, even Senator Ralph Recto will recognize that the sole motivation for replacing it is to remove the corrupt individuals. I will repeat, only one person has been removed in PhilHealth thus far, despite all the documented cases of corruption.
Okay, now there's still so many issues we can talk about, of course, but I just, two quick questions before we go is, what's the strategy in terms of you making it to the top 12? I mean, clearly you are running with Mayor Sara, so that's a big help, but how are you today? What are your numbers?
Well, I've seen three surveys, all privately commissioned. Only one was publicized in the newspaper.
Okay.
The first one, I was 17. Then the second one, I was 15, and there's the latest one where I'm 11. I think the strategy is just to tell people precisely that Harry Roque was already Harry Roque before he became spokesman. If you liked Harry Roque as spokesman because he accorded you the right to freedom of information, he gave you accurate and, of course, fast information. Yeah.
But you don't believe that you being a spokesman was a minus? You've seen, I'm curious, I'm sure you've seen the memes about Harry Roque on social media. You know, social media can be very vicious, and there's so many memes about you. I mean, a spokesperson.
Let's put it this way. As soon as I left, my conversion doubled.
Doubled.
I went as low as 9. I started at 18 in November of last year, and then it went down to 9. And that's why I threw in the towel also. No, why bother when you have a conversion of 9? No way you could win. But after 1 month without me doing anything other than I was out of the position as spokesperson, it doubled to 18. Mm-hmm. And that's what prompted me also, no, to rethink my position, plus the fact that meanwhile, Inday Sara also decided to run. So I thought it was a conspiracy of events. Oh.
So with that alone, I mean, honestly speaking, it shows negative nga maging spokesperson.
Hindi ko naman sinasabing hindi siya negative.
Diba? With the numbers that you quoted.
Hindi ko naman sinasabing negative yun kasi nga, you have to speak on behalf of the president. And more often than not, of course, you have to speak on matters which are not pleasant. No? You have to speak about contentious matters. And I guess when people found out that it was just a job, then they realized who I really was, then the numbers changed.
All right. My last question is, did you learn anything from your loss at the ILC bid? Was that a humbling experience for you? Did you self-reflect? An article I read said you had the least votes, and clearly Filipinos themselves rallied against you. So what did you go through? I mean,
well, number one, you know, my conflict with these people all started when I bolted away from Kabataan Makabayan. These people never grew up. It's been 35 years and they still have that grudge that I was the very first rejectionist. So to me, it did not come as a surprise. Number two, yes, I was a bit disappointed, but it took me 20 minutes to recover. Why? Because it's a realization that you don't win a UN post in the General Assembly on the basis of merit. The currency in UN elections is quid pro quo. It's a written statement saying we will vote for you, but in turn, you will vote for us for this position. We thought that as the last person to be nominated, that merits will do it. And clearly, in my campaigns, people knew I had the most meritorious platform because I was clear on what I wanted to do, vaccine equality, as well as rising sea levels, proposing actual solutions, no, on the basis of customary international law. But in the end, we only had 62 quid pro quos, comparing with a country like Vietnam that had 130 quid pro quos. No? Mm-hmm. And the second realization...
So you're saying it's the quid pro quos that affected you and it's not the rallyists?
Certainly not.
Really?
You know, unfortunately, in the UN, they don't care about NGOs. That's not the venue for NGOs. In fact, many Europeans could not really care about human rights record because remember, the other candidates for the position included China, Vietnam, Mongolia. These are not really the paragon of democracy and human rights. No? But-